Hey, my name's Anthony Sellers, and this is 64 Sessions. This is my version of Justin Timberlake's Suit and Tie. Can't wait till I get you on the floor, good looking. Going out so hot and just like an oven. Oh, burned myself, I just had to touch it. Cause you're so fire, it's alright. Hey baby, we don't mind all the watching. Cause if they study close, real close, they might learn something. She ain't nothing but a little doozy when she does it. And that's alright tonight. And as long as I got my suit and tie, I'm gonna lay it all on the floor tonight. Baby got fixed up to the nines. Let me show you a few things. All pressed up in black and white, and dressed in that dress of light. Love's been swinging in the air tonight. Let me show you a few things. Let me show you a few things. Show you a few things about love. While we're in the swing of love, let me show you a few things. Show you a few things about love. Hey. Let me get a good look at it. Ooh, so thick. Now I know why they call it a fatty. Oh, it's so sick. Got a hit and now it's a habit. And you're so fine. You're all mine. Oh, gonna show them who you call daddy. I guess they're just mad cause, girl, they wish they had it. Ooh, my killer, my thriller. Yeah, you're a classic. And that's alright. Cause you're all mine. And as long as I got my suit and tie, I'm gonna lay it all on the floor tonight. Baby got fixed up to the nines. Let me show you a few things. All pressed up in black and white, and you're dressed in that dress I like. Love been swinging in the air tonight. Let me show you a few things. Let me show you a few things. Show you a few things about love. While we're in the swing of love, let me show you a few things. Show you a few things about love. Hey.
All right, what's up? We're back here in 64 Session Studio, and I'm here with my buddy Anthony Sellers. What's up, man?
How's it going?
Good. Thank you for coming in and doing this, man.
No problem.
Appreciate it.
It's actually a blessing, man.
Yeah, dude, you're one of the first people I've done that I don't know at all.
Yeah, I have that effect on
so
people.
So I'm kind of excited to get to know you a little bit,
yeah,
man.
Sure.
So we were just talking a little bit, and you were telling me how you play a little bit of everything.
Yeah, yeah. I started around 15. I started out with the drums. And, well, I guess I started a little younger. I started at 7 taking piano lessons and then kind of took a break.
Mm-hmm.
Come back around 15 and learned how to play the drums, which was unique. I had knee surgery from a basketball injury, so I just had to tighten down the hi-hat and kind of stick one leg
yeah.
over, you know.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
But migrated from there to the bass and then to the acoustic and then just kind of developed and then got into church music. And
have you always sang, or did that come later?
You know, that really kind of developed more when I started playing acoustic on guitar around probably 18 years old.
Jeez, man, that's awesome. I wish I could sing. That's one of those things that where if you don't, I mean, I guess technically you could take lessons and get a little better, you know, but that's one of those things you just kind of got to be born with, man, in my opinion, I think.
Yeah, you know, well, I've always, you know, I've always wanted to sing like Garth Brooks, and so I would, I mean, yeah. either Garth Brooks or Justin Timberlake, one of the other.
Dude, good albums.
So I'll crank them up in the car and turn it on. I took a few lessons here and there, but it was just something that just kind of.
You took some vocal lessons, that kid?
Very, very small amount, maybe a couple months.
I mean, what's like a basic?
Really just vocal control and breathing techniques is the biggest thing.
That makes sense.
A lot of people fall flat when they sing, man, because they just don't know how to hold themselves.
Guilty. That makes sense. I try to do, some harmony. I can hear it. I can sing it most of the time, but, like you said, going flat's probably my...
Yeah, one of the exercises, man, they'll show you is you have to run these scales while you're slowly turning your head.
Really?
And just doing that forever, and it's just so repetitive, but it builds those muscles to be able to hold those notes.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. That's weird. Well, I play a little bit of everything myself, man. I started with drums. I started like when I was, well, I say I started when I was three. I got my first little kit when I was three. Now. Yeah. But I started, and I'm strictly an ear guy, man. I started with I would turn the radio on, put headphones on, and I would play, try to mimic what I heard. Mm-hmm. And my dad was always a musician. My brother's a musician, and they're ear guys too. My brother, he learned how to read in school. He was in the band too, but he was kind of more of an ear guy. My dad's an ear guy. So my dad would learn songs by, he would wait for them to come on the radio, record them on a cassette tape, mm-hmm. and play them back and just play it line by line, pausing it, memorizing the line. That's how he learned a song, literally.
Yeah.
So that's how I thought you learned the song, So I would just put the headphones on and play along. I started doing that when I was like 8 or 9, mm-hmm. Picked up guitar a little later. Then first band I was in, nobody around here played the bass. We could find people to do everything else but the bass. So mm-hmm. I just said, screw it, I'll play the bass.
Yeah.
So I played a little bit of everything too, man. But so do you have a musical family as well, or are you like the black sheep?
I'm basically it, man.
Really?
That's mean, my mom sang in big choirs and stuff in church growing up, but other than that, dude, it was just kind of me, just my thing. Like I said, I always just kind of wanted to be Garth Brooks, and then you sing like him, whatever. But music's it just inspired me, man. And
have you ever seen a Garth Brooks show?
I got intense. To see when he came to Birmingham.
Yeah, I did too. It was great, wasn't it?
The best concert I've ever
done. I know. I was kind of hating on it a little bit, because I don't like arena shows normally. Mm-hmm. I was like, because you normally can't hear mm-hmm. really very well, and it's just crowded and everybody's drunk, and it's just dude, totally worth it.
Yes,
and he does like 2 shows a night.
It's crazy.
I don't see how he doesn't drop dead.
I don't either.
He's running literally the entire time. It's crazy.
And he's like double our age too.
I know. Yeah. I know. Ridiculous.
I can't even run down the yard to the mailbox passing out.
I know. No kidding, man. Especially and then trying to sing and play guitar and do that.
Yeah, no doubt.
But he's still rocking the headset though.
Yeah, he is.
See that.
Yes. This is a song that I wrote for my super sexy wife, Mary. Should I not say that? Okay, this is a song. This is a song that I wrote for my super awesome wife, Mary. It's called Go Slow.
Like the bright skies shining beautifully now, I can't find one cloud. When you're around, the room spins, I feel wild like a child again with a new best friend. All I know is that you change the world, you change mine, and that's just fine. Darling, wherever we go, let's be sure that we go slow, so we know that we've given it all we can. We didn't really live to any and we were free souls, and we look back to say we would do it all the same. Whoa, 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 whoa. You keep me warm in the deepest cold, the deepest is cold, even in unending snow. And you could light a darkened scene, 'cause your beauty shines so vibrantly, and you don't even know. All I know is that you changed the world, you changed mine, 'cause you're so fine. Tell me wherever we go, let's be sure that we go slow, so we know that we've given it all we can. We didn't really live to any plans, 'cause we were free souls, and we look back to say we would do it all the same.
So, were you in any bands growing up, or were you just like mainly? Because I know a lot of people around here get their start in church. I was talking about that with, I guess, Donnie the other night. Mm-hmm. But is that how you started, or did you have bands, or what?
Oh, no, actually, the way I didn't even start in. Well, I guess I did start drums in church, but when I started playing guitar and being a front man, I didn't do start in church there. I met a few guys, a few buddies of mine, Adam Aaron and Jamie Woodley and Matthew Cooner, and we just kind of all got together, and we had a band called 413, and we had a good run for about 2 years, man. We played probably 200 shows in 2 years, just all wow. over the place. Yeah, it was
like churches or
different churches, different youth rallies.
Yeah,
a couple of community events. We played a couple of festivals, like one in Trustful, and we just played everywhere, man.
Was that about the same time as I cannot remember the name of it, but Ron Wingo's band with John Dodd and Jim and all them?
It was a little bit after that, but I tell you, the band that was kind of going at the same time was Ohio Avenue.
That's yeah. right. Yeah, yeah, with the Dilworth guys.
Yeah, 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 all those guys. Yeah. We were all kind of playing together.
That's
at the
right.
same time.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I forgot about it. Those guys were great.
Yeah, man. They were awesome.
Yeah.
They kind of ran off and left us a little bit because they were just fantastic.
I remember we did some competition with, actually, my dad and my brother started, or I played with their band. They kind of had it started, a Christian band.
Mm-hmm.
And I played drums for them a few times, and we did some competition at Visionland.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Did y'all do that?
We didn't do it. We were thinking about it, but
yeah.
But
well,
I heard
they,
about it.
Ohio Avenue won.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, man, I've known Chad, you know, my whole life, mm-hmm. and I was like, man, that's awesome. I never really heard them until then. And I was like, I went to their MySpace back
yeah.
then, and
yeah.
I was like, oh, well, no wonder they won.
Yeah,
they're
yeah.
freaking awesome.
They're great,
dude.
Man. Derek can sing, man. So great.
Incredibly.
Yeah, they were great.
Good. Yeah. What's Derek doing now?
He's just leading worship, I think. Oh. Towards Huntsville in that area somewhere, I think.
Oh, okay. So he's still in Alabama?
Yeah. Yeah.
Cool, man. Mm-hmm. That's awesome. So where are you? Are you the pastor? Or?
I am. I am a pastor.
Okay.
This is my 10th year being a pastor.
No way.
Yeah. My 10th year being, not just a, like 10th year being a senior pastor at Awaken and Life Church up close to Duncan Bridge on Smith Lake up there in Curry.
Cool. Yeah.
Yeah, this November started my 10th year.
You said Awakening Life Church?
Awakening Life Church, yeah.
Okay. In Curry. So is that past, do you go past the bridge coming from Jasper?
It's about a mile before you get to the bridge on the
okay,
right.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. So do you lead worship there, I guess?
I did for a long time. Then I've had, God's really blessed this man with so many great musicians
yeah.
at that church, dude. And it got to where, I kid, this is no joke, man. Like, there was one point when the church first started, I was leading worship and playing the drums at the same time. Like, we were just that, like,
sweet.
In need, you
yeah.
know? So I had a mic. I was like, what's the guy from Genesis that, what, Phil
oh,
Collins?
Phil Collins,
yeah.
Yeah,
I was Phil Collins, and, you know, I But now God has just really sent us like a ton of great musicians, and even Donnie James. Sorry.
Yeah, Donnie James. I'm representing him. Yeah, tonight, man.
He's joined the squad, and he's. I don't even have to lead worship anymore. Cool. I miss it, but it's good to kind
of
sit back.
It takes a little bit of a burden off your shoulder. I'm sure. Just one less thing to have to prepare for.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah, man. 10 years. So how old were you when you started?
I was about 25, 26.
Wow, yeah. That's a lot for a 25-year-old mm-hmm. to have on your shoulders, man.
Yeah,
that's
I never really thought about it. It was just one of those things where the testimony is actually really neat because it was never my desire to be a pastor. And it was always I was a music guy. I just liked leading worship. It was my thing.
Yeah.
And it was at this point where our church that we were in was just about to kind of close and collapse. It wasn't about 10 or 15 people there, and I was going to resign from my position in this meeting and just lead worship on the road. That's just what I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. just drive around and lead worship, whoever would have me. And I was sitting on the stage in this meeting. I was about to tell him my resignation, and the Lord spoke to me and said, protect my people. Now, I know that might seem weird, but to me it made sense because I looked out and I saw these people who were hurting at the place the church was at.
Mm-hmm.
And so God just kind of called me to kind of stand up and protect them, kind of like David stood before Goliath even, you know, just somebody to stand up.
Yeah.
And I went to the board and I had talked to them about that, and I told them if they wanted me to be the pastor that I felt that I could do it and to give me a shot. And I just hadn't even, like, something like 5,000 sermons later, I haven't even looked back.
That's crazy. So that's your, did you go to Lee or anything?
No. For a little while, I was actually, I worked a full-time job for a long time, and I went to Southeastern Bible College.
Oh, yeah.
So that's where I was for a while, and just kind of finished that up. So I worked full-time, went to school full-time, and pastored full-time for a very, very long time.
Jeez.
Probably 3 years of that, and then I moved into full-time. Right at that 3-year mark.
That's real easy, huh?
Mm-hmm. makes it better.
Yeah.
You know? This is called Broken. That's a song I wrote about what I feel like it really means to be a Christian sometimes. Pressed on every side, troubles will not die, but I will not be crushed. You're making me alive. Questions ever fighting, always asking why, but in your name, Jesus, I will keep on rising. I am broken, undevoted, emptied out for you. Fill me up again, there is no place I'd rather be than in the potter's hands, mending all my pieces. Sorrow in our lives, making wounds that we hide, struck down but not destroyed, you're making me alive. Questions always rising, always asking why, but in your name, Jesus, I will keep on rising. And I am broken, but devoted, emptied out for you. Fill me up again, there is no place I'd rather be than in the potter's hands, mending all my pieces. I am broken, but devoted, emptied out for you. Fill me up again, there is no place
I'd rather be than in the potter's hands, mending all my pieces.
Let's get into, so you write your own music.
I do.
let's get into your process. I'm very interested. I ask everybody's going to be like, you ask the same questions. Mm-hmm. But I'm interested in people's songwriting process, man. So sure. Just kind of run me through one.
Well, what even started the idea, I think, of me writing a song, and it's actually what made me want to start playing guitar. I was more just really into the bass and drums for a long time. And
the funk.
Yeah, I love
that
funk,
man. I know, I did too.
And that was just my thing. And then I remember, this is kind of funny, the first day I got high-speed internet, Charter come out to the house yeah. and put in some high-speed internet.
You remember that day.
I do.
I know.
Very vividly. You know, and so I go on to AOL still, you know, because that's just what we do.
Right.
And there was this live concert streaming to AOL or something, or maybe even Yahoo. Something.
Right.
And I was like, well, this is the first time I'm going to get to watch some video on the internet. I'm going to click it and watch it. And I clicked it, and it was Dave Matthews Band, Central Park.
My favorite band. That's, dude, that is, oh no. That is terrible.
That is very terrible.
I don't think it hit that hard.
So I clicked on this video, and it was the Dave Matthews Band Central Park concert.
Yep.
And I've never, like, I mean, I've all, you know, you hear the Crash, I guess, was the big song.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? And so, but I clicked on that concert, and I didn't care if I knew him or not. This was the first time I get to hear something live on the internet.
Right.
So I just watched the whole concert, and man, I was, like, captivated. And it just, for whatever reason, his guitar ability, his lyrics, they all just kind of just captured me. And so I said, I need a guitar. And
yeah.
I need a guitar now.
Yeah.
So I got a guitar, man, and there wasn't really, YouTube really wasn't a big thing back then.
I wish it was. I wish it would have been.
Sure.
Yeah.
So I had to do like what you said, like you and your dad did, like I just had to get these CDs and these like music DVDs and stuff, and I would just rewind it and learn it.
DVDs were great. They were very helpful when they came out.
And so I started learning all these methods and all these things he was doing, and I wanted to write lyrics like he did. So I wanted to write music that wasn't just this 5-chord, same old, G, C, D, E minor structure. And so I just started writing different stuff with lyrics that wasn't so, you know, encased in the same mold.
Yeah.
And that was kind of my method. I just, I don't sit there and like, I mean, a lot of times just a thought or a feeling, like a song that I'm going to do tonight is just like this feeling that I had for my wife. Like, what if we were 80 sitting on this porch rocking back and forth and said, you know, I wouldn't change nothing about what we've done.
Yeah.
You know, and just kind of, I just started writing
just
around
on that.
Yeah.
Cool, man. That's kind of more in the ballpark of the way I do it too, man. I kind of build off of either an idea or I'll come up with like a good line, like one good line, you know, and I could kind of build something off of that a lot. But
yeah,
you know, I'm just kind of now rediscovering the old songwriting passion. You know, I put it to bed for a long time. You know, I just kind of recently picked it back up. And it's not. That's why the people who, which I've been known to do it, I've been guilty, but people who hate on, especially country music radio nowadays, you know, I get it. I get why they're hating on it. I think it should be a separate genre.
Sure.
I think it should be like pop country or something.
Yes.
I think that's their argument because the songs are good, I think. Especially when you sit down and try to write a song and realize how freaking hard it is to write a song.
Yes.
Like anybody who can write a song gets my applause, man.
Yeah.
Because it's very difficult. A lot of people don't understand that. But back to Dave, man, I got a cool story about Dave.
Okay.
I almost, I was to the point in playing the drums where, because I was kind of playing bass a lot more, I was kind of to the point where, on drums where I was like, man, I'm so bored with drums. Because all the drumming on the radio, this is so stupid, I felt like I had mastered.
Sure.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Which is so far from the truth, you know, now that I know more now. But my point was, it was getting boring. It's kind of, you know, repetitive. Just
yes.
One, four, four timing, you know, boom, tap, you
yeah.
know. And so I was kind of getting bored with it. And I knew Crash.
Yeah.
Like everybody else.
Sure.
And I was like, it's a cool song. But the drum part on that song is not the best representation yeah. of Carter Beaufort's ability, man. Because that my friend was like, no, dude. Put in Live at Central Park, the CD.
Mm-hmm.
Blew my mind apart, man.
Yeah.
I was like, that's how you're supposed to play the drums, dude. I mean, totally rebirthed the fire inside of me to play drums again, man.
Yeah.
I'm serious. I've got that's where I draw my most influence from that dude, you know,
yeah.
stylistically. And
he's the greatest, in my opinion.
Oh, man, he's fantastic, dude.
Yeah, he's the greatest.
He's the only guy that I'll let slide wearing drum gloves.
He does wear drum gloves.
He's the only guy that's allowed to.
He drums like, you know, he drums backwards too, you know.
Yeah, he plays open hand.
Yeah,
I know, man.
That was captured my eye right off the bat.
I heard the story. I watched like a little documentary or something, DVD on him, Under the Table and Drumming.
Yeah.
It's his drum
yeah.
instructional DVD. And he explained why. He said when he was like three, he remembered going and watching, I can't remember who he called by name, but it was a pretty well-known drummer. At the time, he watched him live when he was a kid, and that guy was I think he played left-handed or something.
Mm-hmm.
So the way, or I forgot, something like that. So the way he mirrored it, he wound up playing left-handed like this instead mm-hmm. of like this. I don't know, something about the way his head figured it out.
Yeah,
that was a terrible reenactment of that story. But just
makes
check
sense
out
to
for
me.
Yourself, dadgummit.
Yeah.
It's on YouTube, I'm sure.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He is amazing, dude. They're all just amazing.
Oh, dude, ridiculous, man. Like, I got sad when Leroy Moore died.
Oh, I know.
What a freak accident.
It was, and it to me, it's just not the same. And now, even Boyd Tinsley's out, you know, but I don't know if you knew that or
I
not.
I did not know that.
Yeah, he got let go at the beginning of this year.
He got let go?
Oh, they fired him.
What?
We better not go into detail about that in the interview. But he did some really bad stuff.
Oh, no.
And Dave got pretty upset about it and whoosh, cut him. But they picked up this guy, Buddy Taylor, maybe, or Buddy.
Okay.
Buddy, somebody. He's an organist and a keyboard player.
Okay.
And that sucker's bad.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah.
But did I just break your heart with
a little bit. Yeah.
Boyd's gone.
So what happened to Butch Taylor?
I thought he was going to bring Butch back, but he quit. He just kind of quit, too.
People that quit those bands like that, I'm like, man, it must be something must be really bad to want to quit.
It's gotta be
something that cool,
yeah.
You know? But I guess, you know, a lot of stuff goes unseen.
I mean, yeah, you know, they get on the stage and make magic for us, but what goes on behind the stage, you never know.
I know, man. It breaks my heart when I hear about these killer bands that hate each other.
Yeah,
you know, like I guess because they spend so much time together, you know,
sure.
They just can't stand each other. That breaks my darn heart, man.
Yeah, yeah.
Especially
yeah.
when I like them, you know.
Yeah.
Like the Black Crowes, that's one of my favorite bands of all time.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, you hear they obviously hate each other, and they're brothers, you know.
Yeah.
And you hear that he's a jerk, Chris,
yeah.
you know, by himself. But I guess that's life on the road and being a rock star and
yeah.
sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
I guess it's part of it, man.
So this is one of my favorite songs that kind of got me into acoustic guitar and playing guitar to start with. It's called Where Are You Going by Dave Matthews Band. Where are you going with your long face pulling down? Don't hide away like an ocean. You can't see, but you can smell, and the sound of the waves crash down. I am no Superman. I have no answers for you. I am no hero, that's for sure. But I do know one thing, that's where you are, is where I belong. I do know where you go. That's where I wanna be. Where are you going?
long away. You are growing weary. You can rest with me until a brighter day, and it's okay. I am no Superman. I have no answers for you. I am no hero, oh, that's for sure. But I do know.